Welcome back, folks. Today what we're going to do is continue on with thermochemistry, and we're going to be covering something called Hess's law. This is named after somebody named Hess. The name is not terribly important, but what it is going to do is allow us to do something kind of tricky, and that is we can figure out a roundabout way to determine the amount of energy involved in a chemical reaction. Now, the way that this works is there is a table in the back of your textbook, and it lists a whole bunch of chemical reactions and how much energy is either gained or lost. Now, they cannot make a table long enough for all the chemical reactions that you could possibly dream up. But through Hess's law, you can take a few of those chemical reactions and manipulate them to somehow look like the chemical reaction that you have, and therefore figure out how much energy is either gained or lost. So that's how Hess's law works. And an example of this, and you don't need to write this particular piece down, and just put your eyeballs on this for just a moment here. The idea is equation number three. Now, equation number three is taking methane, which is natural gas, reacting it with water and giving us hydrogen and carbon dioxide. This is an industrial way that we produce hydrogen for different sources and such. But if we wanted to know how much energy is released or gained in that reaction, reaction three, you know, we might not find that on any tables. But the top two reactions, those are in the back of the textbook. And if we imagine those equations where they have the arrow as being like an equal sign, and if you have something on either side of an equal sign, they can cancel out. So for example, on this one, if we look at equations one and equation two, you can see that there's three hydrogens on both sides of the equation, and so those could cancel out. And so if we take the things that appear on both sides, we cancel them out, and then just add what's left over, we end up with the bottom equation, equation number three. So equation one plus equation two, just crossing out what's duplicate, gives us equation three. And so if we add up the enthalpies, the delta H's on the right-hand side for one and two, they should equal three. So it's a roundabout way of trying to determine how much energy there is in that bottom equation. Now, there are some rules for this. The rules tell us that if we take a reaction and we revert, tripping over my own tongue, right? It's like, okay. So if we take the first reaction there and we reverse it, we need to change the sign. So if I take, for example, here N2, and it's important to put in the states of matter because sometimes you could have more than one state of matter, like water, or H2O could be a liquid, a solid, or a gas. So it's a good idea to keep the states in there. So nitrogen plus oxygen gives us two nitrogen monoxides. And this involves, 180 kilojoules. And the units on this is kilojoules. It's typically kilojoules per mole. Now, if we reverse this reaction, in other words, we just take it and flip-flop our reactants and our products, we'd have two nitrogen monoxides, give us nitrogen gas plus oxygen gas. And if we do that, we need to reverse the sign over here. So this delta H then becomes a negative. Did I miss a? I missed a zero there, didn't I? No. Okay. Okay. Should be a negative 180 kilojoules per mole. So if I reverse the sign, or excuse me, reverse the equation, I need to reverse the sign. And then the other one there is if you multiply an equation by something. In this case, we're multiplying it by three. Then you multiply everything by three, including the amount of energy. So if you multiply an equation by some number, you must multiply the enthalpy by some number. Any questions on that? Okay. All right. So then let's try an actual problem. Here's a reaction that gives us iron ore, iron 3 oxide, plus carbon monoxide gives us iron and carbon dioxide. This is a reaction that they use in the smelting process where they take iron ore out of the ground, they react with carbon monoxide to give us iron to make things like automobiles and such. So we're going to have to manipulate these two equations to equal that bottom, or excuse me, the top one there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to write out these equations and then we're going to do some manipulations here. So let's start out then with 2Fe solid plus 3/2 O2 gives us Fe2O3, and the enthalpy on this is a negative 824.2 kilojoules per mole. The other reaction is carbon monoxide plus oxygen gas gives us carbon dioxide, and the enthalpy on this is a negative 282.7 kilojoules per mole. And when we're done, we want this to all add up to what that top equation is. So that's Fe2O3, 3CO, all right. So we need to manipulate these top two reactions to somehow end up with this bottom one. The way that I approach this is I try to see what's on what side of the equation, imagining these being like equal signs. So for example, I see iron 3 oxide here is on the right side of the arrow. It's on the right side. And over here, it's on the left side. So that tells me this top equation, I'm going to have to reverse it. I'm going to have to reverse this top equation. And if I reverse that top equation, that means I need to change the sign here. And then I look down here and I see, all right, carbon monoxide is on the left-hand side. It's on the left-hand side, so I don't need to reverse this one. But I do see that there's three carbon monoxides here. And I have only one here. So I'm going to take this one and I'm going to multiply it by 3. So that means I'll put a 3 here, and then I'll have 3/2. And then a 3 there. And then I need to multiply this by 3 as well. Now, I need to then cross out what appears on both sides and somehow end up with this equation. And for me, the way my brain works, it's a little hard to do that just looking like this. So I'm going to take this top equation here that I reversed, and I'm going to actually write it reversed, just so I can see how things cancel out. So I'm going to take my Fe2O3, and oh, I didn't put the state in there. I think that's solid. Okay. And that's going to be 2Fe solid plus 3/2 O2. Okay, so I'm just cross that out like that. Okay. Now, I'm just going to look and see, okay, can I cancel things out here? I don't know. Does anything cancel out? The oxygens do. Excellent. Okay, so I've got 3/2 oxygens here, 3/2 here, which is the same as like 1.5, right? So I'll just cancel those out. Okay, and I think that's it. And so when I'm done, if I just take these top two equations and add what's left here, it should equal this. Does it not? So then I can add these two together. And if I did the math right on this, 3 times this is a negative 848. 848.1. And then, let's see, if I then add those together, I ended up with a delta H is equal to a negative 23.9 kilojoules per mole. Now, is this endothermic or exothermic?
A few moments later.
It's exothermic. Yep, this one's exothermic. The sign is negative. It's exiting. Energy's exiting. It'll have less energy when it's done because it's losing energy. It's negative. Okay. Yes. It'll be, so how do we know what the sign is, whether it's positive or negative? That'll be given. It'll be given. So that's like a whole table, one of the appendices in the back of your textbook with a whole bunch of these equations, and it'll tell you positive this, negative that. I look at this as almost like a puzzle. It's like, I need to get this, and I'm given these two. I just need to figure out, you know, what do I multiply it? Do I divide? What by how much? Do I reverse it? To somehow end up with this. Like a puzzle. I like puzzles.